Hi, I'm Norman Wildberger, and today I'm going to tell you about circles and how to parametrize them. So first of all, let's think about the simpler issue, that of a line. Here's an example of a line in the Cartesian plane, and it goes through the point 1, 0, 3, 1, 5, 2, and so on, and it has this Cartesian equation, x minus 2y equals 1. Let me remind you, that means that every point on the line, x, y, satisfies that equation. Now there's another way of thinking about that line, of how to describe it. That's called a parametric equation instead of a Cartesian equation. Here's the parametric equation for the same line. What does it mean? Well, for any value of t, the point 1 plus 2t, comma t, satisfies this equation. That's easy to see, because this x-coordinate minus 2 times that y-coordinate is always equal to 1. Geometrically, what the parametrization means is this. We start at the point 1, 0. The direction vector for the line, that vector right there, is the vector 2, 1. Now, if we start at the point 1, 0, and we go any multiple of the direction vector, then we stay on the line. The multiple can be positive or negative. So that expression reduces to that, and that's how we get the parametrization for that line. The Cartesian equation and the parametric equation are in some sense dual or opposite to each other. We can generalize this situation. If we have a general line, equation ax plus by plus c equals 0, then that equation can also be rethought in terms of alpha plus beta t, gamma plus delta t for some numbers alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. In other words, every linear equation can be linearly parametrized, and conversely. So a natural question is, what happens if we go to somewhat more complicated equations, representing more complicated curves? The next level, naturally up, is that of a second degree equation, an equation in x and y that's of degree 2 at most in both x and in y. So we're also allowed to have terms like xy that also counts as degree 2. Now Fermat and Descartes realized that equations of this form described exactly the conic sections of the ancient Greeks. By that we mean circles, ellipses, parabolas, hyperbolas. Everything that can be formed from a cone by slicing it appropriately with a plane. The natural question is how to parametrize, or how to find a parametric equation for a curve like this, a conic in this form. The simplest and most basic conic is a circle, and the simplest circle is the unit circle, that one right there in red in the Cartesian plane, which has this as its equation, x squared plus y squared equals 1. That's the equation of a circle because this left-hand side is exactly the quadrants of a point xy to the point 0, 0. So this equation is telling us that the quadrants of an arbitrary point to the origin is equal to 1. In other words, it's describing all points of quadrants 1 from the origin. So a natural question is, how do we parametrize the circle? Now at this point we come to a very common misunderstanding that is universal even in high schools and in universities. Most people think that to parametrize the unit circle, you should think in terms of sine and cosine. It's not right. You have to change your thinking. Here is the right way of parametrizing the unit circle. 4 out of 5 times, this will be a better parametrization than the cosine theta sine theta parametrization usually found. Let's have a good look at it. It's a little bit complicated. All right? So for every value of t, on the left here we have 1 minus t squared over 1 plus t squared. On the right we have 2t over 1 plus t squared. First of all, the claim is that every value of t gives us a point on the circle. How do we check that? Well, we need to check that if you square this, and you square this, and you add them, that you get 1. But that's the same as saying that if you square the numerator here, and add the square of the numerator there, then you get the square of the denominator. And that is a simple identity that goes back to Euclid. In fact, Euclid was well aware of this parametrization of the circle. This parametrization goes back much earlier than the cosine theta sine theta parametrization. Another indication that it's better. However, there's a slight sort of technicality that we need to mention. Not quite every point on the circle is given in this form. There's one kind of exceptional point, and that's the point right here, the point minus 1, 0. It's impossible to choose a value of t so that this point here is the minus 1, 0. Unless you kind of allow t to be infinity. Okay, whatever that means. But in some sense, t being infinity somehow corresponds to that particular point there. All right, let's have some look at some examples. If t is equal to 2, plug t equals 2 into here, you get minus 3/5, 4/5. That's a point which is right about there. Okay? And it corresponds to what's called a Pythagorean triple. Three numbers that are the side lengths of a right triangle. Okay, so in this case it corresponds to the Pythagorean triple 3, 4, 5. If we plug t equals minus 1/3 in, then we get 4/5 minus 3/5, which is down here. And that also corresponds essentially to the same Pythagorean triple. If we plug t equals 4 in, we get minus 15 over 17, 8 over 17, and that corresponds to this rather a more unusual Pythagorean triangle, one with sides 15, 8, and 17. These are distances here, because there's no little boxes, these are not quadrances. To get the quadrances, you would square these three numbers. So this parametrization of the circle, very ancient, very long-standing, very beautiful, goes back to the ancient Greeks and ultimately really to Pythagoras and the idea of a Pythagorean triple, three numbers that form a little right triangle. But now we can ask, where geometrically is this number t? We have some point like this on the unit circle. What is the geometrical significance of t? Let's answer that. So here is our picture of the unit circle. There's a special point, minus 1, 0, which we'll call A. And here's an arbitrary point on the circle with the parametrization we talked about just previously. Now I claim that if you join A and C, and you intersect the vertical axis, you get some point B, whose first coordinate has to be 0 because it's on that axis, and whose second coordinate, the y coordinate, is t. So the significance of t is that it's exactly the y coordinate of the intersection of the line joining this point to our variable point on the circle. It's remarkable. Why is it true? Well, it's very easy to see just by thinking about vectors. The vector from A to B, and that vector is 1 over and up t. So it's the vector 1t in round brackets because it's a vector. The vector from A to C, we take the difference between coordinates. So this minus this is this plus 1, and this minus 0 is just 2t over 1 plus t squared. Simplify this, get that. Then pull out the common factor 2 over 1 plus t squared, you get a multiple of 1t. So the vector AC is a multiple of the vector AB, and that proves that these three points really are in a straight line just like that. Parametrization of a circle, the geometrical significance of t, a very important picture. Next video, I'm going to show you how to think about complex numbers and rotations. Again, just from a rational point of view. No transcendental functions. I hope you'll join me. I'm Norman Wildberger, and thanks for listening.